My dear Saraswat, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, it is a privilege for me to be here and to commence the proceedings today with a recital of our heritage, of our identity, who we are and where we come from. Where you are going is very much a product of where are you coming from. And as Saraswats, we have our origin on the banks of the Saraswati River. It's therefore very essential, next please, it's therefore very essential for us to...
Slides please.
Yeah, slide, next slide, yeah. It's very essential for us to take a look at our history. Those who do not learn from history, next. Those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. Now, you cannot have your history written in, you know, Harvard or Massachusetts or Oxford. You have to own your history. Because so far for us, because we were a colonial, we were colonized, our history was colonized, our minds were colonized, and we still haven't recovered really from that, psychological conditioning of the British Empire. Now today we have to take a re-look at our history in the light of new facts and knowledge that has come up in so many other spheres. So you can't get stuck to, you know, Max Muller or Macaulay because Max Muller said so. I'm afraid Max Muller did not have access to satellite imagery. I'm afraid Max Muller did not have access to radiocarbon dating. Max Muller did not have access to DNA mapping. And a whole host of new disciplines where we've got a plethora of new facts and knowledge, which we must now utilize to rewrite our history in the light of the truth. A civilization that says, Satya Meva Jayate. Then you have to go for the truth. You can't take hand-me-down narratives from the British Empire and 75 years after independence, continue with the same. So today we need to reclaim this history, and for that we need an integrated approach, a convergent approach, a multidisciplinary approach. And one of the key things that we have to look when we take a look at our history is that the Marxist, colonial, the liberal, leftist historians, one of the first things they deny is the existence of the Saraswati River. You and I don't exist because there was no Saraswati River. It was a myth. It was a story. Kahani hai. Aap bakwas karte hain. Aap bakwas karte hain because we will give you now. They say, the Americans say, don't tell us, show us. So we will today prove to you the existence of this river, and we will also take up a series of very seminal questions about ancient Indian history today. Next, please. Thank you. Yeah. So what are these seminal questions? Which was the cradle of the Indian civilization? Sab log kehte hain Sindhu River. Sindhu, because the Arabs could not pronounce S, they called it Hindu. Hum Hindu, Hindustan. You know, when the Greeks came, they saw the Indus River, Indus, Indica, India. So, by default, the Indus River has become your cradle river. And I shall show to you that this is not the fact. About 80% of the Indus, so-called Indus Valley settlements have been found not on the banks of the Indus River, but on the Saraswati River. We shall cover that when we go ahead. Now, the sacred geography of the Rig Veda is defined by the Sapta Sindhava, the seven sacred streams that flew in the Punjab area, Haryana area, Rajasthan area, going up to Gujarat and Kutch. So, was this the original Rig Vedic area? Is the Harappan civilization and the Rig Vedic civilization one and the same? They occupy the same geographical area. What the British told you is, what Max Muller told you is, sorry, but they were in different times. The Aryans came 1500 BC. How did you come to this magic number? Because the world was made as per the Bible in 4500 BC. So, Mesopotamia is the oldest civilization. How can the Indian civilization be older than the Mesopotamian civilization from which, you know, the Western civilization traces its roots? So very neat, back of the envelope calculation, 1500 BC, that is the gospel truth. You dare challenge it. You dare challenge it. We are now. And we are telling, we have told Madam Romila Thapar so many times, please IA for a seminar. And let's go by facts. She refused to come. Oh, you are right wing, you are this, you are that. I was in the Vivekananda International Foundation. So many times we invited this lady and all these leftist historians to come and debate and discuss. That is the way. No, this is the gospel truth. What is the strategic direction of the Indo-Aryan migration? Was it from Central Asia into India? Or there is a reverse theory now which is called out of India theory. Was it from here outwards? We will cover this in detail. So are the Aryans alien or are they indigenous to India? And these two separations, the Indus, so-called Indus Valley civilization and the Vedic civilization, are they the same or were they separated in time by about 3,000 years as Max Muller said? Next, please. You know, a picture is worth a thousand words. Please take a look at this picture. Those purple dots are settlements, right? Now take a look at the Saraswati River, which is running parallel to the Indus River, right? If you see there, the densest cluster of settlements is along the Saraswati River. Almost 80% of these settlements were not on the Indus, they were on the Saraswati River. So it is not really the Indus Valley civilization, it is really the Saraswati Valley civilization. Next, please. We had done a seminar in Delhi University about 4 years back, and then we had taken a multidisciplinary approach. We took a look at the Aryan invasion theory, which was later changed to Indo-Aryan migration theory. Because when the facts did not fit, you just very conveniently change it. Oh, they didn't come to invade, they migrated. Okay. And as I shall show you, that is a logical absurdity. The Saraswati River dried out and vanished. So, if the Ganga dries out, you think people from outside वहाँ मरने आएंगे? इसा पानी नहीं है, हम यहाँ आएंगे. You will come where a river is lush and flowing. You see, and not where a river is desiccated and dying. The whole theory does not stand the test of logic. In the second session, we had, you know, the geological aspects, the satellite imagery aspects, and we went over the Landsat satellite imagery, ISRO satellite imagery. Then we went into the hydrodynamics of the rivers, the paleo channels, how they have changed. There's a whole science which is now available to us. We had these experts. Then we covered the archaeological evidence. Then we did the gene mapping, population mapping studies. And then we studied the linguistics and the scriptural evidence. Based upon that, I came out with my book, that is the Saraswati Civilization, A Paradigm Shift in Indian History. Next, please. Now the Nadi Sukta, you know, India is a land of sacred rivers. Our rivers are sacred to us, whether it is the Ganga, it is the Yamuna, the Saraswati is the most sacred of our rivers. The most sacred original river of ours. But the Kaveri, the Narmada, these are sacred streams. Why? Because the water absorbs the prana. You see, when a rishi meditates, the prana shakti is aroused. The kundalini is in the pranic field. You see, that gets aroused and the water is the first to absorb that shakti. Tabhi kamandal leke chalte the hamare rishi aur shraap dena hota tha. That was the charged water, water charged by meditation. That is why our rivers are so sacred to us. Now, you know, that is why today we have the Ganga as the holiest river. But if you go to the Vedas, the holiest of all streams is the Saraswati. It was called the Sindhu Mata, the mother of the Sindhu, the mother of all rivers. It was called Naditama, Devitama, Anuttama, the greatest of all rivers, Naditama, the greatest of all Devis, Devitama, Saraswati, and the greatest of all mothers, Anuttama. The fact is, this was name of the Saraswati appears 74 times in the Rig Vedas. It is called the greatest river, glorious, loudly roaring, mother of floods. Now, Max Muller says, and see the logical fallacy. Max Muller says, Aryans came 1500 BC. Geologists tell you that by 1900 BC, this river had dried out, finished. So how did they see the Saraswati? And if they had at all seen the Saraswati, they would have seen some broken lagoons. And south of Jaisalmer, it had gone underground. It is still underground, Vinashana ke aage. So how did the Aryans then write about the Saraswati river? Because he said they came in 1500 BC and they composed the Rig Veda here, right? So how did they talk of the Saraswati as a loudly roaring mother of floods? There is one shloka which says, the Saraswati uproots the tops of the mountains like an elephant uproots a lotus. You are talking of a mighty, you know, roaring river of floods. You're not talking of a dying out stream. So by logic, this is what Max Muller said, doesn't stand the test of, you know, scrutiny of logic. Thank you. Next, please. Here is a satellite imagery. Don't tell us, show us. Dikhaiye. The first American Landsat satellite in the 70s that went and sent back photographs of the dried out course of the Saraswati. And then of course our ISRO satellites. We called the ISRO experts and they showed us the whole mapping of the satellite imagery of this river. Next, please. Now as per this satellite imagery, not as per my faith or my belief or because my grandfather told me. No. Satellite imagery evidence shows this river was 4,600 kilometers long, 6 to 8 kilometers wide, and at Patiala, where the Satluj used to join it, and the Yamuna was flowing westwards earlier, used to join it. Iska part, it was 20 kilometers in width, right? And then what happened to this river? Tectonic plate shifts, huge earthquakes. The first shock that came, that turned, you know, the course of the Yamuna in three shifts, it turned eastwards. I'll show you the satellite imageries. Turned eastwards and joined the Ganga. So half the ice melt water was depleted. And then after that, a few thousand years after that, the Satluj turned course and joined the Indus River. And therefore, all the ice melt water was deprived. It became a monsoonal stream. Just before the Mahabharata, there was a massive 12-year drought. Yuganda tha sahab wo. And then this river died out and vanished. 1900 BCE, before the current era, this river had fully dried out. And this is where Max Muller stands negated. He says, we came in 1500 BC, the Aryans. The Veda was written then. And the Veda in 1500 BC described the Saraswati as a loudly roaring river. Saraswati had gone. Either the geologists are wrong or Max Muller is wrong. And Max Muller certainly is wrong. Next. Here is one of the best photographs of this. This has been touched up to show the river. But this is a satellite imagery. The sky blue stream that you see, that is the Saraswati. And you see it flowing from the Himalayas. You know, it takes its origin in the Mansarovar Lake and then goes down to the Ran of Kutch. This is the Saraswati and it is running parallel to that deep blue river which is the Indus. Take a look at this. This is visual evidentiary value. This is scientific evidence. Next, please. This is another satellite image which shows you, you know, if you see towards the south of this, the dark bluish Ghaggar Hakra Paleo Channel That is the Saraswati, right? And you can see the Satluj flowing on top. And this is another image of Rakhi Gadi. You can also see on this photograph, satellite imagery of the landscape. Next, please. So what happened to the Saraswati? Like I said, 4,700 before present, there was a massive earthquake and the Yamuna changed course. Then 2,600 years before present, there was another earthquake and this time the Satluj changed course. And then, you see, when it was deprived of the ice melt water, it became a monsoonal stream, flowed for another 1,000 years, and then by 1900 BCE, this river had vanished completely. In the north, it became confined. When you go to Kurukshetra now, dekhe, when we die, our ashes are immersed in the Ganga. Where do you go for Pindadan? To Kurukshetra. Why do you go to Kurukshetra? Because the Saraswati flowed through Kurukshetra. Abhi we Pindadan. Look at the strength of the oral tradition. Koi record nahi tha iska, kahin nahi hai. But yet the people, by the oral tradition, kept alive the memory of a sacred river and sacred stream. Akbar's cavalry, they knew of this dried out course. And whenever they had to travel north to south, they would take their cavalry along the dry course of the river. You dig a few feet deep and you get water for your horses and the men. Sweet water. And south of Jaisalmer, this river has gone underground. And even today, the army is taking out water, and we all know the plans that we have. And if you take that water out with tube wells and the others, you will green. Rajasthan will become greener than Haryana or Punjab and will be our next granary. Next, please. This is another very interesting image. If you see that dark brown line on the top, you know, which is going, that is the Shivaliks. And if you see towards this lower end of the photograph, there was an earthquake and that caused a kind of a cut in the Shivaliks. So the Yamuna near Paunta Sahib, which was going straight and joining the Saraswati, as the Drishadwati stream, the Kurukshetra battle is supposed to have been fought between the Saraswati, Drishadwati. Saraswati to the north, Drishadwati to the south. That was the line of the Yamuna. And when this sheer fault took place in the Shivaliks, it got an opening and the Yamuna then turned eastwards and progressively joined the Saraswati. Next, please. Now this, you see, this is a representative thing. You see on the extreme right of this, there is the Y3 channel. Next to it is a Y2 channel. And then there is the original Y1 channel or the Saraswati channel. So in three shifts, it is gone, and instead of joining the Saraswati, it has gone and joined the Ganga, right? And therefore, whenever you go to the Ganga and the boatman takes you to Sangam, he says, Saab, ye hai Ganga, ye alag rang dekh rahe hain, ye hai Yamuna, aur Saraswati underground chali gai. So people thought it's just a story, but it is actually gone underground. It's actually gone underground. Next, please. This is that underground channel which, you know, has been mapped out in detail, and lakhs of cubic liters of fresh sweet water is available in the desert, and they are taking it out by the tube wells now. Next, please. So as I said, more than 60% is an incorrect earlier estimate. Now the estimate is 80% of the Indus Valley sites are on the banks of the Ganga, and therefore the Arabs, the Greeks, the British, they all got it wrong. They all got the name of India wrong because they followed the wrong river. Before they came, the Saraswati had gone, which is the mother of our civilization, which is the cradle of our civilization. Next, please. Once again, I'm showing you this. You see the cluster of settlements along the banks of the Saraswati is so much more dense than the Indus. The Indus is an outlying river. It is not the core of your civilization. It's not the core of your civilization. Therefore, please don't call us India, really. Because we are a Saraswati-based river. Next. This is again another satellite photograph where they have superimposed these settlements, and you see they are not on the Indus River. Next, please. So now let's take a look at the archaeological evidence. One of the doyens of Indian archaeology is Professor Lal. Now, you see, we haven't been able to decipher the Indus Valley script. But we have found a new proto-language. You know what that proto-language is? If you go to the Indus Valley sites, there are a number of terracotta dolls, toys, which have been found. And that doll, that toy speaks for itself and tells you the whole story that you want to know. And it is an amazing story. There are toy bullock carts. There are little toys of women. And on those women, on the center of the forehead is a bindi. Look around this hall. Most of our girls have the bindi on the center of their forehead. Still, every married woman in the Indian tradition has the vermilion in the center parting of the hair. I will show you those images of those dolls which have these, right? And then of course, okay, let me show these to you. Next, please. Next. Take a look at this. These are the dolls which were recovered from there. And if you see that reddish one, if you see closely, there is the mark of that bindi still there. And there is the mark of the sindoor. And this is about, sir, 5,000 to 6,000 years old. Look at the continuity of the Indian tradition, right? Look at the strength of the Indian tradition. It just carries on. It just carries on. Next, please. You see the bangles on this Harappan doll, and you see the bangles on the right side. These are present-day bangles, and that is 5,000 to 6,000 years old. That bangle tradition continues. Next, please. These are statuettes that were found in the postures of yoga. You see the next slide? It's a little more clear. Yeah. You see that, you know, Surya Asana, Surya Namaskar poses, some of them. You see so many of these asanas. The Vajrasana you can see at figure 3. You see Pavan Muktasana and so many of these asanas. Anjali Mudra. It's all being shown here. These are 5,000 years old. Next, please. There are some more of these Harappa, Mohenjo-Daro, these postures of yoga in those dolls. Terracotta dolls, they have been found. Next, please. Now, what is this man saying? As per the British, he was half asleep. He's not half asleep, sir. He is meditating. Dhyana. What are the two characteristics of the Rig Vedic civilization, of the Indian civilization? Yoga, Dhyana. Both these are there. 5,000 years ago, those people who lived along the banks of the Saraswati, those who lived along the banks of the Indus, they were doing meditation, they were doing yoga. And yoga continues till this day. Meditation continues till this day as an essential practice of Hinduism. So to all this fancy theory, Dravidians are separate and North Indians are separate, spare us that crap. DNA mapping shows there is no difference in the genes north and south of the Vindhyas. There is no difference. So don't give us that invented theories to make us divide so that we would fight amongst ourselves and somebody else could rule. Next, please. Here is another picture in the, actually it's, you can call it Sukhasana or Siddhasana, a meditative posture. This is Pashupatinath, surrounded by animals. Next, please. You want any proof of continuity? See the Shivalinga. See the Shivalinga. And you know what are these leaves which you see on the right side? These are people. People were sacred 5,000 years ago. It is sacred today. Next, please. Very interesting. Look at this bullock cart. Actually, if you take measurements, the bullock carts that are there in our villages today are almost the same measurements, same ratios. Right? This is a bullock cart toy which has been found in the so-called Indus Valley civilization. Next, please. This is the boats, seals of the boat. And that is a boat which is there today, still used in Gujarat. Just see the designs of the boats. The boats that designed that was 5,000 years ago on the Indus Valley so-called seal, in the Saraswati Valley seal, is the boat which we still use, that design. Next, please. What is this? I ask you. Take a guess. Ye kya hai? Hum mein se jo gaon mein gaye hain, schools in the villages, wo phatti hota tha. Uske upar, you know, used to put chalk and then used to write with some coal or something of the sort. These have been found in the Indus Valley so-called civilization, in the Saraswati Valley civilization. You see the continuity? Next, please. These are some of the beautiful pottery which has been made there. And a lot of the designs are what you have today. You may have them in steel, you may have them in aluminium. But the basic designs of the pots, pans, storage, gharas, everything is the same. Next, please. This is a very interesting slide. You know, on the right side top, you see a terracotta doll. And a number of these dolls have been found in Mohenjo-daro, in Harappa, and these places. Now, if you see what they have on their heads, they have something like round discs with dots. So they were wondering what these dots are. Till they found, show me the next slide. Next. Yeah. Take a look at this mushroom. This is called the Amanita muscaria. Red mushroom with white dots. Now go back one slide. Go back. Yeah. You see this, the things that she has around her head are the same mushrooms. These were supposed to be psychotropic mushrooms. And Professor Gordon Wasson says this is Soma. This is Soma. So the Soma is a Rig Vedic concept. And the fact that it was found here, you know, all that theories that, you know, that was not a Vedic civilization, it was anything but a Vedic civilization, this, I think this doll proves it wrong. Next, please. Next, next. When you see, this is Mohenjo-daro from the top. It almost looks like a chessboard. It almost looks like a chessboard. Chaucer, Shatranj actually has come from there. Next, please. This is the drainage system of Mohenjo-daro, right? And I'm afraid it is better than the drainage system of Delhi or Gurgaon or Haryana today, where every year we have floods, you know, on our roads. We have floods on our roads. Next, please. And this is, they said, you know, one of the things that shows that the Indus Valley civilization was not Aryan, was not Indic, that, you know, they had come from, it had no chariots. We found chariots here. To bola nahi sahab, is chariot mein to, there are bullocks, there are no horses. Next slide. Now we found the chariots, Baghpat chariot, discovered just 2 years, 2.5 years back, and announced to the world. You have found the chariot, and you can see the design of that chariot, so-called looking so Greek, is there in the hand of that man. We found the wooden remain. The problem is that in the tropical climate, wood doesn't last long. So it's very rare to find a wood chariot of that era. But here it is, we found the evidence. Hardcore evidence. And we got hardcore evidence of the skeletons of horses along the Indus Valley civilization. Now, next please. Radiocarbon dating has demonstrated that Bhirana, one of the sites on the Indus Saraswati civilization, is 8,000 years old, the upper levels. And the deeper levels, sir, ladies and gentlemen, are 9,500 years old. The way age of the Vedas gets pushed back to almost 10,000 years ago. And that is quite right, because the Vedas are talking of an ice age, more or less, which happened 10,000 years ago, the latest ice age, right? And that froze the rivers in the north. The Sapta Sindhava streams were frozen. And therefore, we have the myth of Indra fighting with the demon Vritrasur, who had frozen the waters. And then the stream started flowing again and life came back to the plains of India. Next, please. Here is Bhirana, 9,500 years old, carbon dated by IIT Kharagpur. They rechecked it with luminescence dating and with fluoride dating. So I'm afraid You know, Max Müller sahab can pack up and go back to Germany or wherever he came from, because we have scientific evidence now. Next, please. This falsifies the Aryan invasion theory that the Aryans came in 1500 BC to India and they are Central Asians. You know, why did the British insist on this theory? Because they had to justify British rule in India. But if they can say, ki sahab, aap to bahar se ho, to bole sahab, hum bhi chor, tum bhi chor. You are also a chor. You are the Aryans who came and looted the Indus Valley civilization. So chor, chor, musere bhai, as the joke goes. You see, they spread this story. But the pity is, look at our lack of self-confidence. We still carry on with the theory. In the hard sciences, our scientists, our IT professionals, our engineers, our doctors are doing so much better in the United States. 30% of NASA is Indians. 30% of Silicon Valley is Indians, right? But in these soft sciences, we somehow are very beholden because we sold out our entire educational fraternity to the left, to the communists and to some other religion people. Next, please. My simple logic. Here is a river which was the mother of the Indian civilization. We know from geological evidence, paleological evidence, satellite evidence that it dried and died out. That desertification took place. The whole of Rajasthan was green. There are seals of rhinos along the Indus Valley, along the Saraswati Valley. Where are rhinos found? Assam, Brahmaputra, dense jungles. Tigers are found where? In the forest, deep forest, tropical forest. All those, we have those on the banks of the Indus Saraswati civilization. So quite obviously, you see, my basic logic is, when a river dries out, where will the people go? They will go out from a river which is drying out. So most of the people of the Indus Saraswati Valley civilization, when the rivers began to dry out, moved east towards Ganga, Yamuna, Doab, and then went further up the valley, right? And those who were on the western banks, they moved via Afghanistan, they moved into Central Asia, they moved into the Middle East. There are tablets that we have which record a treaty which has the Vedic gods as witness. The Vedic gods as witness, right? Vedic gods appear in the treaty signed between the Hittites and the Mitanni. They said, with Indra, Mitra, Varuna, Nasatya as our witness, we signed this treaty. And by the way, all the rivers in Europe, most of them, are, you know, derived from the name Danu. The Danavs were pushed out of India, right, by the wars. And their mother was Danu. Now, the rivers of Europe are what? Don, Donets, Dnieper, Dniester. These are all the same rivers because they are Indians and they have been pushed out. It's not that people came from outside and civilized India. We went out and we spread our civilization. Next, please. I will end with this slide, my presentation. On the left is a seal from the Indus Valley, Saraswati Valley civilization in the Anjali Mudra, the Namaskar Mudra. This is how you and I greet each other. That dancer is a present day dancer. This is the age, continuity and persistence of the Saraswati Valley civilization. You are Saraswats because your ancestors were born and brought up on the banks of the Saraswati. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to take 1 minute more of yours, with your permission, Ashok, 1 minute more of yours, and I'd like to tell you that it is your and my duty to do our Pitri Rind, or to pay off our Pitri Rind and to pay off our Guru Rind, right? I am, along with my son Aditya, who's here, and my nephew, who's here, we are trying to, next slide, there's a blank slide, then just show another slide. Just go next, please. Yeah. There is the Vedic mythology, the story of how Indra destroyed, you know, the Vitrasur, who had frozen our rivers, who had stolen our rivers. All these Vedic legends and mythology is there. We know Ramayana, we know Mahabharata. But how many of our children know the Vedas? You ask any child, Hindu child in a school, which is the Hindu holy book? Gita. I'm sorry, that's not correct. Ye to Upanishad hai Gita, which is derived from the Vedas. The original Vedas, you know, are four, but we don't know. So we are trying to restart the Vedic mythology, just like you have anime, the Japanese film now coming up, you know. So we are going to start the Vedic mythology. We will seek your, whosoever wants to assist in this. Next slide, please. Yeah. So we are going to start the Vedic gods, goddesses, the Vedic characters. Do you know that there is a Dasharajan Yudh in the Vedas? Do you know that there is a Dwadash Rajan Yudh in the Vedas, as big as the Mahabharata? We don't know about that mythology, so we want to recreate that mythology through documentaries, through films, through comics, and now web series, NFT, Metaverse. We will spread this mythology. Anybody who wants to help, most welcome. Next slide. We are Brahma Kshatras. My father's side is Parshuram. My mother's side is Dronachari. That's why you generally mostly see me angry on TV, because that's my gene. That's my gene. But ladies and gentlemen, we need to spread the Kshatra Bhav. We need to become Brahma Kshatras to defend this civilization. 800 years, you've been ruled by one invader after another. And what did we learn from those invasions? They came and they burnt our cities, they destroyed our villages, they broke our temples, they raped our women, carried them off to be sold in the brothels of Bukhara and Samarkand. Sone ki chidiya, kahan gaya aapka sona? Loot, loot ke le gaya ye sara. I think enough. What have we learned from this 800 years? Gandhigiri. De di hame ajadi bina khadak bina dhal. Don't insult our dead. Don't insult our dead. We need to get the fighting spirit. What you see is we started a series of war comics on our Paramvir Chakras, Ashok Chakras, Mahavir Chakras, these war comics. Next, you can see Sandeep Unnikrishnan. Here you can see Arun Khetrapal. And Bana Singh and Nirmaljeet Singh Sekhon, the new mythology of military heroes, Indian heroes, heroes in the here and now. Ye nahi ki they were great yodhas only when Arjun and Abhimanyu and Bhim were there. We have yodhas like him now. 13 bullets in his body, still fighting fit and strong. We need to celebrate the bravery. We need to celebrate the courage and the sacrifice of the armed forces. Get that ethos, get that fighting spirit. If somebody slaps you on one cheek, turn the other cheek. My foot! My foot! We must become Brahma Kshatras, all you Saraswats. You must now promote this culture that you, tum aankh utha ke dekho, hum tumhara aankh ukhaad ke baar de. We will do it. We will do it. Next, please. Next. And we've also started, because we found that these were not reaching out enough, the printed comics. So we have digitized. We have created a Shaurya series. You may have seen it on Republic, on our wars after independence and on our Paramvir Chakra winners. We are right now, this is on Kargil, what we did on Tololing, the Battle of Tololing. So seven of these have come on the Republic channel, they have come on the Times Now, Aaj Tak, and we are going to go more, 10, 15, 20 more, we are going to go into this, so that the fighting spirit in this country needs to be revived. If any one of you can help, last slide please. Next, connect with us, Bharat Patriot Foundation, and help us to promote patriotism, nationalism, sacrifice and courage. Thank you very much. Jai Bharat, Jai Hind. जब हमारा पलटन लड़ाई के लिए जाता था तो हम लोग जोर से गरज के अपना पलटन का जो है युद्ध घोष बोला करते थे। हम देखना चाहते हैं कि हमारे सरस्वत भाई बहनों में कितना जोश है। मेरे साथ बोलें, जय हिंद। ये पाकिस्तान नहीं पहुंचा, एक बार फिर जय हिंद। Now it's reached Islamabad. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have 5 minutes time for question and answer. Please, sir, have a seat, sir.
Any questions? I'd like to take them on.
Just a moment. The mic will be given to you. We have a scope for 3 to 4 questions only. Please raise your hand. We'll give you the mic.
Yeah.
Tell me, please. Sir, being a Saraswat, whether our origin is Dravidians or Aryans, who are we?
Dravidian, I'm sorry, it comes from the construct, if you hear Subramaniam Swami, you know, where the three oceans meet, right? The Dravidians and the Aryans are both exactly the same as per their DNA. The DNA mapping has been done, and north and south of the Vindhyas, there is no difference, right? It is just that the Aryans, who Arya is not a race or a tribe. Arya means a gentleman. Arya, aap kahan ja rahe hain? Arya, aap kaise hain? Arya means gentleman. Anybody who is good, who follows the Vedas. The first divide was done by a British bishop who tried to give us this pernicious theory of the divide across the Vindhyas. We are the same people. We are the same people as our languages, as we have pushed out towards Central Asia and Europe, the languages have changed. As we have pushed out south, languages change.
But that's all right. We relate to more south. Our Shankaracharya, G.S.B. Shankaracharya, relate to south, not of the other part of India. So I think we are Dravidians.
Then I'd leave it to you. But what I'm trying to say is, Dravidians are Indians. Aryans are Indians.
These are two cultures, different cultures. Different cultures.
Odias are different, they've got a different language. People of MP, people of Gujarat have a different language, but at the end of it, hum sab Bhartiya hain.
Next question.
Hello, sir. Sir, one point. Yeah. One submission that you mentioned about, Pindadan, Piova.
Yeah.
Likewise, there is a place called Kapal Mochan,
yeah,
where Shiva came for Brahmahatya Dosh.
Yes.
Yeah. I believe, sir, Parashuram had gone from Gomantak, because he is supposed to be from Goa area,
right,
to Kapal Mochan area, and did tapas there also.
That's
the place next to is Jagadri. Can you mention something about Jagadri, sir? Because is it the origin of Saraswati River, or is it further away in Himalayas?
One
question is that. And secondly, so we are behind, like Saraswati disappeared, Saraswar also disappeared. And this is the first time I think confluence like ASCO has done it 2-3 years, 4 years back in Mumbai. So we are getting together now. I think there is a message which is supposed to go to across the world about the Saraswat also.
You are the cradle of not just the Indian civilization. You are the cradle of the global civilization. Everything has come from here. You are the ancestors of almost the whole world. Really, because everything has spread from here outwards. It is not the Euphrates and the Tigris which is the source of the global civilization. This is about 2 times older. We are older than the Chinese civilization, right? So the fact is, we are the cradle of the globe, the global civilization, the Indian civilization, and it's about time that we came back to our river. The place Jagadri that you are mentioning, once the original Saraswati, actually origination point is in the Mansarovar Lake, from where the Satluj comes out, and it was the bulk waters of the Saraswati were from the Satluj and the Yamuna, ice melt water, right? When the Yamuna changed course, joined the Ganga, And then the Satluj change course joined the Indus. This became a monsoonal stream whose origin was then traced to Jagadri. But the origination point is there in Mansarovar Lake. And that is why the next time the Chinese feel funny, I'm sure the paras will be at Mansarovar.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, next question.
Yeah, sir, I would like to...
Just a moment.
Yeah.
I have 2 points, sir.
Please, sir.
One is in 1974, I happened to go to Varanasi.
Yeah.
Where I met an Israeli who was in search of his ancient roots. So I was sitting at Manikarnika Ghat when he came, and I was the only one who was speaking English there. So he took me along with him to a sadhu who was living about 4 or 5 kilometers from there. And that sadhu told him that the Jews, that the civilization of Israel, which they call Jews, is actually the established by Hindu Rishi. And if you see the Star of David, it is akin to Akash Tattva as well as Prithvi Tattva with Bindu inside. That is the first point. Therefore, what you say that the Hindus, Saraswat Brahmins, who migrated from West, went up to Middle East, and this tablet was found in Jerusalem.
Right.
That is the fact. So if that can be corroborated. Second is, while I was in the area of Rajasthan, it was 92, I happened to see the ancient maps of that area. In the area of some, you know that particular place, area, Jaisalmer and Ahad.
Yeah.
There is a long trail of water coming underground.
Absolutely.
And it was then, with the help of ONGC friend, I got it drilled.
Yeah.
At 800 meters, the water came out.
Yeah.
And it was sweet water.
Yeah, absolutely
till
sweet
day.
Water.
These were the
he
two.
He is areas. Absolutely right. And there is a plan now to link the Rajasthan canal, take out this water, link it, and get the Saraswati on top. They are debating this, because some people feel that if you get it on top, ek to wo ho jayegi dushit jaise Ganga ho gayi.
Yeah, last question from the gentleman there.
And then it'll evaporate. So take it out from below and green the desert. Aur jahan tak sawal hai Jews ka, Chandranadi wale log, और सूर्य नाड़ी वाले लोग ये चंद्रवंशी और यहीं से गए
यू
आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट
यस सर हेलो सर सर हियर
ओह देयर यू आर
या सर हेलो सर फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल थैंक यू टू एक्सप्लेन अबाउट द हिस्ट्री एंड यू टोल्ड दैट बेस्ड ऑन your point, I'm going to add one more point to you.
Only one point I'd like to add.
You told that historians have changed the thing. So what I would like to say is that rather than invaders, our history is now changed by the historians mostly. If you go to Qutub Minar complex, what they say is it is not the temple that they have destroyed, but they have Indians people have constructed the masjid in the way of temple, because they don't know how to construct a masjid during that time. How they changed the means they don't know how to construct a masjid, so the way they have constructed a masjid in the way of temple, like that they are giving. Because if you go to Qutubuddin complex there, you could see the every evidence of the temple. So this is the way historians change the way of things. What is the way to stop this kind of foolishness
people are telling?
That's my question. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. You see, like the Ram temple, they said it was a mosque. You go down and you find the temple there. Like I said, people have come and destroyed our temples. The lesson that we can't change what happened in the past. We can change what happens now and in the future. No bloody question of another temple being touched. Can't be touched. Because aap aur main ladenge uske liye. And we will not kacho the, you know, kato the charkha. There, we will fight. And as it is, India is becoming a great military power. We have broken Pakistan in two. General Saab or I, we are from the generation. I mean, we fought the Bangladesh war. 13 days, Pakistan was broken in two. So don't think of that era where we were, our temples were destroyed and our women were raped. It doesn't happen. The country which tries that will not survive. Pakistan pehli baar mein do mein toota, is baar wo char mein tootega.
Thank you very much.